Thank you. BioTalk series hosted by the Department of Biotechnology from St. Joseph's College of Engineering. The speaker for this session is Dr. G. C. Jayakumar, who will be talking about collagen-based materials biomedical applications. Before we start, I request you to follow a few instructions to ensure the smooth sailing of the event. Please do not introduce yourself in the chat box and kindly post any questions you have in the chat box and they will be answered during the Q&A session in the end. If you face any technical difficulties at any point, relay them in the chat box and we will look into it. The feedback link will be posted in the chat box and it is necessary to fill it up to receive the e-certificate. Ensure you enter the correct details as they will be used to generate the certificates. We will now begin on an auspicious note with a Tamil Thai Valka. Dr. Chamundeshwari to deliver the welcome address.
Thank you, Ms. Swatika Prabhakar. Hi, everyone. A happy evening and a warm welcome to all the faculty members, industrialists, research scholars, PG and UG students, my colleagues, and my dear students who has registered and actively participating in this online webinar, BioTalk Series 8, from various institutions across the country. This type of BioTalk series was conducted successfully by our Department of Biotechnology for the past 2 months, and more participants have actively participated and got innovative ideas related to their research and recent advancement in various fields of science. As a continuation of it, today, a BioTalk series of 8 is being conducted. So, on the behalf of the Department of Biotechnology from St. Joseph College of Engineering, I welcome you all to the BioTalk Series Week 8 on the research topic, Collagen-Based biomaterials for biomedical applications. I take immense pleasure in welcoming our eminent speaker for today's session, Dr. G.C. Jayakumar, who is a scientist at the Center for Academic and Research Excellence in CSIR CLRI, Adyar, Chennai. Once again, I welcome you, sir, and thank you very much for your acceptance within a short notice of time. I feel very happy in welcoming our patrons, Dr. B. Babu Manoharan, Chairman, St. Joseph College of Institution and St. Joseph Institute of Technology, Ms. Desipriya, Managing Director, Mr. B. Shashishekhar, Director, Dr. Vaddi Seshagiri Rao, Principal, and Dr. B. Parvathavadini, Dean Research. I also feel very happy in welcoming our head of the department, Dr. G. Srikumar, and advisor, Dr. V. Renka, who continuously supported for this biotech series to happen for the past 2 months. Apart from this, I would like to welcome my colleagues and finally our students, Ms. A.R. Niveta, Ms. Swathika Prabhakar, Ms. S. Swathika, and Mr. N. Kumaran, who are continuously supporting in organizing the biotech series through online platform for today's and previous session. Now I request the head of the department, Dr. G. Srikumar, to take over the session and address this gathering. I welcome you, sir. Yeah.
Good evening, my dear students and participants. Hope everything is fine and going well. As you all know, every week we have a practice of keeping BioTalk lecture series and bringing the eminent biotech personalities through webinar and sharing their research views to the entire biotech community that include students, teachers, and research personnel. We have successfully conducted 7 such lecture series and received good responses from the participants. For the sake of new participants, I wish to highlight some of the credits of our college and the department. St. Joseph College of Engineering is one of the top engineering colleges in India with 160th position as per NIRF ranking currently. It has got 26 years of high reputation in educational society with the NAAC A+ grade accreditation and having 10 UG programs and 7 PG programs with an affiliation from Anna University, Chennai. Our Department of Biotechnology is more than 1.8 decades young and having B.Tech and M.Tech biotechnology programs. The department has got sophisticated laboratory facilities and fetched research center recognition to do PhD and MS by research and having more than 1.1 crores of rupees as government funding to conduct research. Since inception, every year, our biotech students, they stand first in receiving highest number of university ranks that are declared by Anna University. Coming to today's talk, it is collagen and its application. Collagen is a hard, insoluble fibrous protein that makes up 1/3 of the total protein content of the human body. It is found in the bones, muscles, skin, and tendons, etc. It is the one that acts as a supporting structure and holds the cell to each other and ultimately holds the entire body together. Collagen-rich tissues are the material for medical application, such as absorbable sutures, medical surgical sutures, and tissue repair and replacement, soft tissue augmentation to support wound healing and wound dressing, etc. Recently, the use of collagen as a carrier for drug delivery has attracted many researchers throughout the world. Collagen-based drug delivery systems include injectable microsphere based on gelatin. So, we understand that no wonder why collagen is now widely used in both research environment and medical application. By keeping all these things in mind, Department of Biotechnology has decided to organize this week's BioTalk lecture on biomedical application of collagen. For this, we have an eminent personality with us who is an expert in collagen-based research, Dr. G.C. Jayakumar, scientist, Center for Academic and Research Excellence at CLRI, Chennai. We welcome you, sir. At this moment, I wish to comment about our participants also. There are 663 participants, they have registered, and out of them, 376 students of both an UG and PG level and 287 faculties and research scholars together. They are from 24 Indian states and 6 countries such as South Korea, Iraq, Indonesia, Jordan, Saudi Arabia, Morocco, Oman, etc. With this proud note, on behalf of the patrons, I wish to inaugurate this 8th BioTalk lecture series on collagen and its biomedical application. I also extend my special wish to the organizer, Dr. M. Chamundeshwari, and my dear student coordinators also. All the best for the smooth conducting of this program. Thank you. Over to Swatika.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words. Now, without further ado, let's get into today's session. The guest speaker for this session is Dr. G.C. Jayakumar. Dr. G.C. Jayakumar completed his bachelor's, master's, and his doctorate in leather technology from Anna University with his dissertation on studies on the role of glycosylation in collagen stability. He has published several papers in well-renowned peer-reviewed journals, such as the Journal of American Leather Chemists Association, the Journal of Physical Chemistry, RSC Advances, and the Journal of Cleaner Production, amongst others. He also has numerous patents related to leather making. He was the recipient of the Mecca Haji Abdul Majid Sahib Endowment Award in 2010 for the best MS research work. He has attended many conferences and workshops, both national and international level, where he has also won awards for his presentation. Dr. Jayakumar used to work as an assistant professor at the Ethiopian Institute of Textile and Fashion Technology in Bahir Dar University in Ethiopia. Currently, he works as a scientist at the Center for Academic and Research Excellence in CSIR CLRI and is also an honorary assistant professor for Anna University since 2016. Sir, it is an immense pleasure to have you with us here today. I request you to take over the session.
Good evening all. Thank you. I first would like to thank the organizers for giving me an opportunity to be a part of this biotech series. As Dr. Chamundeshwari was mentioning, this is a very short notice, but then I took it and accepted so that I can contribute to the presentation. So I think we can get into the presentation. The talk for the today's session is collagen-based biomaterials for biomedical applications. Why I've chosen this topic is being the Central Leather Research Institute is known for biomedical applications, like basically collagen-based materials. Since leather manufacturing is mainly focused on stabilizing a protein called collagen, where we work much on collagen stabilization. What our objective will be focusing more on the leather stabilization, and now we were also deviating and see what this collagen can be also a versatility in biomedical applications. They were, being a leather technologist, have been focused towards the biomedical applications of collagen. I made a presentation more for undergrads and postgrads, a bird eye view of the various applications of collagen-based materials and what are the different forms of collagens are being currently used. The structuring of the presentation is basically what is collagen, what is the structure, the classification, the importance of fibrinogenesis, application modes, and a summary. Collagen is one of the most abundant protein found in the human body, in vertebrates, and it's about like 33% each. The major composition of collagen present in tendons, cartilage, bone, and skins. The major support, the functionality of collagen is support, structural integrity, and cell migration or adhesion, the tissue repairing, regenerations. The collagen functionality is numerous, the biofunctionality. Collagen is a triple helical molecule, that is three polypeptide chains wound together to form a supercoil structure. Now, when we get about what is this polypeptide chains, there are three different polypeptide chains. Each polypeptide chain is about 1,000 amino acids, and these are basically formed with peptide bonds. And then These three polypeptide chains are wound together mainly on hydrogen bonding to form a collagen molecules. Now these collagen molecules are further fibril wound together, or they will have a supramolecular assembly to have different forms of collagen functionality, just like your tendons, cartilage, skin. And what is so unique about the collagen is their repeating units, GlyXY. Every third position glycine is there, which is a very important factor which determines the structural integrity of the collagen molecule. The role of proline and hydroxyproline in XY position is also a very critical factor with a structural stability. The replacement of these amino acids will eventually have a deterioration in the structural stability. Their diameter is 1.5 nanometer, and so far there were about 29 different types of collagen have been reported. Now, the molecules, when a very classical example is a type 1 collagen, where it is again a three polypeptide chains are wound together, where they will have two different polypeptide chains. The polypeptide chains in this alpha 1 and alpha 2 is basically the series of amino acids. The variations will give you a difference in alpha 1 and alpha 2. Then those type we call it as an enterotrimer. When all your alpha chains are going to be similar, we call it as a homotrimer. Collagen molecular structure, as I said earlier, this is a GlyXY pattern, the repeating pattern, where every third position is going to be glycine. That is why, because when the folding pattern is going to happen in collagen molecules, the central axis is a very critical factor where the glycine sits. Now, if the glycine is going to be sit, is because the glycine doesn't have any R functional groups, which is make more compact to sit in the central axis during the folding pattern. And in the cases of proline and hydroxyproline, they are all in amino acids where the steric hindrance stability is going to be contributed to the structural stability of the collagen molecules. And the other unique factor with the collagen molecule is that self-cross-linking. And like any proteins, collagen also will form the transcription and translation process. And the very unique about the biosynthesis with the collagen will be the post-translation modification. In the cases of post-translation modifications, hydroxylation and glycosylation are the two unique things which actually takes place in collagen, which will give a more additional cross-links. In the cases of hydroxyproline we were talking about, this hydroxyproline is usually occurred in the post-translation modification, that is in a hydroxylation. In collagen, the hydroxylation takes place for proline as well as for lysine. In the cases of hydroxyproline, will give you an steric hindrance to the collagen molecule, thereby increasing the thermal stability. Whereas in the cases of lysine, if you take, this hydroxylation of lysine is a very critical factor because those hydroxylysins will involve in the cross-linkings, that is self-cross-linking, which will give a covalent bonding, which in turn will give you a stability to the collagen molecule as such. To put it in a nutshell, these hydroxylysins, where the amino groups, basically these are basic amino acids, where the amino acids are available. Now these amino acids usually get deaminated and then aldehyde groups are introduced. When these aldehyde groups are further interacted with the basic amino acids, and then a shift-based formations will be there, which eventually will increase the strength. That is one of the very unique factors about the collagen molecules in the biosynthesis. And the fibrinogenesis, since collagen is a fibrilla protein, the fibril formation, the fibril forming ability of the collagen molecule is in a very interesting properties, whereas these post-translation modification will always contribute much impact on the fibrinogenesis process. Self-assembling. This is an overview about in the skin, how these collagen molecules being synthesized and what are the different factors it will impact the collagen synthesis. Now, which I said earlier about this transcription and translations. Now, the critical factor about this post-translation modifications and then the formation from the collagen molecules, that is a monomeric collagen molecules to a pentafibrillar level, and then the microfibril or subfibril and the fibril states, that is basically from primary structure, secondary, tertiary, and quaternary structure, folding patterns will give you a more kind of a stability to the collagen molecules. That's why it's been always seen as one of the best candidates for biomaterial applications. And not only that, the people still are working on those aspects on the biosynthesis and what are the individual roles and the secretion of the collagen molecule at different levels and the role of enzymes in the in vivo synthesis. Still, people are still working on the functionality. For instance, we're talking about the glycosylation in the collagen synthesis process, which is a very unique, which will lead to the advanced glycation end products. The functionality, what's the role, and each role has impacted the fibril formations and then the functionality. So this is a type 1 fibril assembly. To add an additional point to it, what we usually do with a collagen fibril study, what we do it in real time is that we usually extract a collagen from very commonly from the tendons or from the skins, and then people usually to reconstitute those collagen molecules. That is, the collagen molecule is either extracted in acetic acid or in an alkali medium, and then it will be reconstituted to a physiological pH, whereas we can study how these collagen molecules are, how these aggregations occurs. It's the way we study, and this very commonly we call it as a turbidity assay. What is this turbidity assay with a real-time application is that collagen, one of the key, not a disadvantage or a backlogs about the collagen molecule is collagen is a protein and eventually it's go for a degradation process. Any applications, when you read or search it in any of the literatures, collagen crosslinkers, collagen stabilized with several metal, organic, inorganic materials are being used. That is basically to enhance their resistance towards the heat and the enzymes, to enhance the functionality. Collagen as such is a good healing material, as such people are using it. But when you try to want to functionalize it and withstand the different forms, people try to use it cross-linking and people try to make it with the composites. Those can be studied with the turbidity assays. So what are the key advantages with the collagen molecule is that biodegradability, biocompatibility, less antigenicity. Collagen is a very strength material unlike other proteins because the way it's being synthesized, the way it gets aggregated, the ordered way of an arrangement is what can be absorbed in the collagen molecule. The arrangement is very uniform with the collagen where the pentafibular level and then it will go for the quarter staggering arrangements where the periodicity, that is the overlapping of one collagen molecule to the other with a 64 nanometer can be absorbed. And the other advantage is a cross-linking mechanism. It's a self-cross-linking where the covalent cross-linking and the glycated cross-linkings occurs in the collagen by itself. So these are the very key advantages with the collagen molecules. What are the different broad applications? I just want to bring to you, not into the, what are the different types of cross-linkers or different types of materials being prepared. I just want to throw a view how these collagen molecules can be used in a different field in biomedical aspects as such. This is to start with this skin substitute, bioadhesives for dental procedures, biotubes as a mesh for repairing tendons and cartilages, for the regenerations of nerves, gels in the forms of hydrogels, bioinks, bioadhesives, and in the forms of membranes, films, and it can be, it is also being used in the vascular tissues. People also attempted to use a micro needle using a collagen where the drugs or the topical delivery people are being used. People are now focusing on recombinant collagen molecules where there's an issue with the animal based people working on the fish. Now people also working on the recombinant collagen molecules from bacteria, from plant. People have writing their hypothesis, and then people working on the bioinks, which is just booming. People are working on a gelatin, and then people also working on a collagen where the tissue regeneration and for different applications people can work on it. Now let's get into each topics one by one, and I have given a very short brief about each, and to make up these undergrads and postgrads to work on in a different perspective when they go for the dissertation work. So bone graft substitute, when you talk about the bone graft substitute, bone replacements is practiced for centuries together. People very conventionally, you know, will be using this demineralized bone matrices, hydroxyapatite and bioactive glasses. Now what this collagen is going to do with this bone graft substitute, collagen, as we are aware, the collagen has a very high tensile strength properties, and cross-linking, using an additional cross-linking, will eventually increase the strength properties. So thereby, instead of going for synthetic-based materials, people are also working on this collagen-based materials for the bone graft substitutes, and this is also being used for bone void fillers. And unlike these other materials, collagen plays a very good role for the tissue regeneration because of the biocompatibility. In all the applications, I just want to emphasize, collagen as a substrate is a very good substrate for cell migrations and cell proliferations. So the compatibility, all the applications are primarily being focused basically for the adhesion properties, which eventually increase the cell proliferations. And people were expecting there will be a 6.5% growth in the cases of bone graft, actually in collagen-based markets in the year 2072-2027. There is a very good scope working on this bone graft substitutes. This is cartilage repairs. Similar to a bone graft, collagens in a different form, such as like injectables or in a hydrogels, people have been also using for repairing the cartilage. There's a more challenge in the cases of cartilage repair. This is usually the cartilage damage with sports MMA personalities is always occurs very quite often, and with aging and repeated movements, this tear off is usually there. Whereas the collagen plays a very critical role in stimulating this cartilage growths, and this can be done it with injectables. People usually use it. But still, when you actually do a literature search and then go back and read, but still it's one debatable what is the impact of a collagen on the repairing stuffs. This is again similar to a cartilage. Tendons also can be repaired using a collagen based products, where in this collagen fibers increase the tendon tensile strength. The one advantage is that when you use collagen-based products for these kind of an applications, they absorb the drugs or a controlled sustained release. So those are the added advantage in the cases of collagen molecules. And the other advantage is about accommodating the multipurpose drugs is also an added advantage with respect to collagen-based products. This is a dental procedures where people also been using collagen-based materials for dental procedures, where they use to control the bleeds, the collagen plugs are usually used. And even in the cases of mouth ulcers, where these collagen-based sponges, collagen-based membranes are being used, that will eventually will lead to an healing tissue regenerations. All these applications, it might be looking that I will be pitching it upon tissue regeneration or wound healing or biocompatibility, or talking about this cell proliferation. Those are the base material why collagen has a diversified applications. So I'm just giving an overlight that yes, a collagen based products can be ventured into a dental procedures is what I'm just putting forward. And for root conditioning is also people use the dental based products. What is the criticality when you talk about the selection of a material? This is the composite what you're going to add with a collagen molecule for different functionalities. So that is the challenge where we have to work on it. Whereas in the cases of, if you talk about the cartilage in cases, the material we were choosing, the collagen-based products, the cross-linking should be high so that an external cross-linking agent to be added for the applications. So where in the cases of the dental procedures, where if you want to go for a kind of applying in ulcers or a mouth ulcers, so whereas the absorption rate should be also there, which can be similar to that of cartilage repairs. The next application is a skin substitute. This is similar to skin replacement therapies, where they are using like an injectables and or a scaffolds on the patches. This is similar to your treating a burn wounds, skin substitutes. The major application will be in a wound healing process. Now, people as such, collagen sheets can be used, but the major disadvantage is that they are prone to biodegradation and bacterial attack. So usually for skin substitute and for wound healing process, an additional cross-linking agent is added, which will also have an antimicrobial properties so that it restrict the contamination or degradation by the external environment. Dermafillers, this is similar to your skin substitute, whereas here it is like injecting, where there is a topical application where in this we inject this collagen solutions to minimize the wrinkles, lines and scars. This is a vascular closure devices and other applications. In this, these have been different types of closures where these collagen based materials are being used, that is suture based and clip based, where these collagen in the surgery concepts or in the cases of very vascular based applications has been very much nowadays people are working and then venturing into it owing to the disadvantages of the inorganic materials and compatibility. The major advantage of collagen molecule is that their biocompatibility and lesser antigenicity. This is a stent grafts where very commonly people will be using with the stents as inorganic based, whereas when we try to use a collagen based stents we get more biocompatibility. There is an and the other the key factor with the stent is about the tensile strength and the ability to pump the blood. So whereas the collagen can be fine-tuned the tensile strength properties by adding an additional cross-linking agent. And the other advantage of using a collagen-based stents where you can have a multi-purpose drug to be loaded and the absorption is also higher rate. But in the cases of stents, that should be restricted. And in our research group, we are also working on collagen-based stents derived directly from animal waste, directly from the animal skins, and then we are trying to work on a cheap based stents directly so that the cost reduction will be there. And the other application for cornea is for cornea treatment, collagen scaffolds been used to regenerate the epithelial cells, and these are used with recombinant human collagen. The collagen roles in cornea treatment and in the cornea shielding are been very much being explored. Whereas the difference between the collagen application in topical treatment as well as with the cornea or an eye application is the transparency level. So that is a very key factor where when collagen based products with respect to cornea, the transparency level will be a critical factor where we have to have a hold on it. The other application is nerve regenerations. Nerve regeneration in the form of hydrogels, collagen provides highly controlled environment for nerve cells to grow by both mechanical and biological support for the nerve cells. And people are now working on it to making it into a tubular forms and then attaching where the nerves can be regenerated. So this is now people also venturing into it and working on it, whether these collagen based materials can effectively be used for the nerve regenerations. Then gene delivery applications, people talking about the other carriers for delivering your DNA, where we're talking about plasmids, virus and other stuff, whereas even the collagen based materials is a very good agent for delivering the genes. So what is that? The very key factors is about the controlled release, the enhanced stability and the transfer of genes via collagen pathways. So the acceptance rate of this material by the physiological conditions is very high when compared to the other materials. That makes it's a very unique and acceptable for biomedical applications. And the other one is that collagen as a dialysis membrane, collagen, when you talk about the reconstitution, if you could recollect, we were talking about this turbidity assay and collagen fibrinogenesis. Now, the fibril formations, once we extract a collagen, and then the collagen can be reconstituted to a film. Now, those reconstitution are making up porous materials where we can have a controlled porosity, and these materials can be very much used as a dialysis membrane. And it's have a wide applications, including in renal therapies. And the other aspects of this dialysis membrane is that not only for dialysis applications, I just want to add it that this is also a good packaging material. People also working on converting this into a packaging materials, but not as such as a collagen, a denatured form, that is a gelatin-based products. And it has also been sometimes people also call this as a bioplastics, where people look into using a collagen into a bioplastic stuff for packaging for food industries. I have not focused on those aspects into a food and cosmetic applications, but I'll add it during the dialysis applications. And this have very good applications. People are working much on this renal therapy treatments. Collagen replacement therapy, this is similar to this dermal fillers, and where collagens are used or injected in the epidermal layers to enhance or to produce collagen, where to remove the scars and wrinkles. So similar kind of this is very much practiced in the plastic surgery, where cosmetic applications, where people are focusing. Collagen-based products are now in the local markets are coming up, collagen-based masks, collagen-based health drinks. Now people are focusing collagen creams. I eventually went through some of the sanitizers. I was like having one, I don't know whether you are aware, there were people talking about hyaluronic acid constituted sanitizers, where they were giving an advertisement saying sanitize while you are glow, so that these hyaluronic acids are enriched so that they produce collagen or enhance the collagen productions. So now people are venturing into it, where these Western and the Eastern countries are very much into this collagen based products, are very much commercial. But even now people are working on the local markets have come up with several collagen based products, and people are using it. And recombinant collagen, now one of the not key disadvantages, but people are skeptical about the collagen because most are from the animal resource and mainly on bovine based products. Now people want to might due to the disease or might be restrictions, people are working towards fish-based products or vegan-based collagens. In that, people are looking out bacterial or plant-based collagen productions. Though these are all at very primitive levels, but people are very successful in bacterial-based collagen productions. And people have also reported plants-based production of collagen-like peptides are also being into the streamline where people want to venture in. People were very successful in the production of in vitro meat production, in vitro skin. There's a company have come up with productions on the lab scale. But what is so challenging with the collagen in in vitro synthesis is, collagen synthesis is a very complex process where it is not dictated with a single molecules or a single materials. There are several factors, several regulators and promoters will come into a picture, and then aggregation is going to be a very critical factor. The one important issues with the recombinant collagen is in a hydroxylation process and the glycosylation process. This post-translation modification has to be induced separately so that you get achieve what the regular collagen is going to be function. So those are the very critical area, but people are working towards where you get the market is huge in the cases of recombinant collagen. Might be down the line, the recombinant collagen might take the markets. And the major advantages will be the productivity cost. See, in the cases of at the lab scale level, the cost will be very high. Might be when there's an upscaling process and then the demand is high, and probably the cost will work out. Stability and storage and biosafety factors as against the animal-based products. And whatever we have spoken is what an application-based. Now we'll go, what are the different forms of collagens are being used for the applications. This is micro needles, which I just want to talk about because this is the area where I'm just venturing into it. Where these, this is nothing but like people who are working on making 3D mattresses and then loading it with collagen and then making into a micro needles. What is so unique about this is like it's a topical release of drugs where the drugs can be loaded. And in fact, the advantages in this, each needles where you can play with different drugs. So that is a multi drugs can be delivered in the same sets. So these are different advantages where people are also looking out with the micro needle. But what is the disadvantage or what is the challenges I would put forward is about the puncturing on the skin with a needle. So those force is what a challenging task in preparing a micro needles from collagen based materials. The other one is collagen shield. That is similar to what we are talking about the cornea treatments, where in this, what is the advantage, you know, these sheets, what the first point is that the transparency level. The other thing is that the withstanding ability is another factor with the collagen shields. So now those are the very critical factors where when we prepare a collagen shield for cornea applications. This is collagen films, which has been very widely used and widely practiced and widely known. So either we call it as a collagen films, whether we call it as a collagen membranes, or we can also call it as a collagen scaffolds. And this is a very versatile, we have been used for several functions, right from the wound healing process. So, and the major advantage is cell proliferations, where these scaffolds also loaded with drugs to enhance the functionality. And these collagen films, what we conventionally or like we practice is that all these collagen films, we use a cross-linking agents. Now very conventionally people use aldehyde based, glutaraldehyde is a very commonly cross-linking agent for collagens. People venturing into a different types of cross-linking agents, then that becomes now key factor. Not with the collagen molecule as such, when you talk about the films, membranes and scaffolds. Now people working on this bio-based cross-linkers, we work in modifying carbohydrates, starting from converting starch to a dialdehyde starch. All the polymers we were working on it to convert into a dialdehyde and then cross-linking so that the biocompatibility is still retained. So that is both a biopolymers rather than using the glutaraldehydes is what we usually work on protein stabilizations for our interest. And the other thing is that we are also attempted in using the enzyme-assisted cross-linking process to enhance the stability of the collagen molecule, where we have used enzymes which will introduce aldehyde groups, and thereby those groups involved in the cross-linking with amino groups, basically a covalent-based cross-linking, where you get more thermal resistance. We have also attempted, and very commonly example would be a transglutaminase, which is used for protein cross-linking. That is a protein-protein interaction which will lead to a protein stability. Collagen sponges are similar to the films and membranes. This is one of the form. The collagen sponges, where as compared to the films or the biomembranes, where with a scaffolds, it's going to be the same applications, and it's very commonly being used for the short-term delivery rather than for a long-term sustained release. The other is collagen gels. Now there will be a series of this collagen gels, hydrogels, bio-inks, where all put together it's going to be a one form or the other, but a different perspective. Now when I talk about collagen gels, I have my own the characterizations where it fit into a collagen gels. Now the main thing will be like the rheological properties is what a very important factor for the collagen to be used as a gels. The other critical factor of the collagen molecule itself is the fibril formations. All these collagen, mostly, not all I would say, like people working on this acidic based on an acid solubilized collagen. Now when working with the collagen, what happens is that when you shift the pH, automatically going to be a fibrils. So that is a very intricate process in handling a collagen as such. So that will be very interesting as well, and controlling where you put more of your knowledge and then come up with this process. So that is a very critical in handling gels. As such, if you take it up gelatin gels, very comfortable as against the collagen gels. Now that is with respect to collagen gels and hydrogels. Now when I talk about the hydrogels, there it comes the network per se, whereas as against the collagen gel as such. Now with this, if I take it up to bioink, probably, just to put it, now with the collagen gels and hydrogels, now people are working on this collagen-based bioinks. Now this bioprinting is actually being focused area for developing different kinds of tissues, regenerations, stem cell therapies, where collagen-based products are being venturing into it. Now many literatures have been reported with collagen plus carbohydrates being used and then making printing activities. We are also venturing into it and working on this developing a bioinks from leather waste and animal waste products. As the major challenges, I would say, because I'm currently working on this perspective, the major challenging is about the rheological properties, the viscosity level, the printing ability, the drying. Unlike the conventional polymer-based drying, where it dries once it's heated up and then liquefied and then it gets printed and dried, whereas collagen is a protein material as such, it's a very difficult process because 37 degrees Celsius is going to be your cutoff temperatures, and then enhancing will also leads to a denaturations, the functionality get changed, and then the compatibility of adding additional molecule to the collagen will also change the rheological nature. So these are the aspects where people are to venturing into it, an area to be focused for the future. I'll take you back. Now, liposomes. Collagen and liposomes, that is like it's in a hybrid materials, lipid plus protein molecules, almost resembling the extracellular materials or matrix. The major advantage would be like you get more versatility, and then adding up multipurpose drugs will be give you a better thing. And then the key thing with the liposomes, that is where the collagen will take a lead, is that the compatibility and targeted delivery will be higher in the cases of when you coated the collagen along with the liposomes. And then that will lead to a higher therapeutic efficacy. The collagen pellets, this is a similar kind of things where people use for control release drug delivery mechanisms. There are now people also working on collagen tablets as such for regular applications. And in this case, these are commonly being used for topical applications for wound, open wounds, ulcers, and burns. And this is maybe we can put it into a category where similar to kind of micro needles, where this will be injected with a syringe to a subcutaneous spaces. The other is nanoparticles. You can call it like the key disadvantages or key challenges with the collagen in making into a particles is a very task, because collagen is in a very high molecular, like 3 lakh Dalton, and making into a particles is a very critical, and then breaking down and then denaturation effect influences also will be there. So but still people have attempted and then making into a different kind of particles. We in our research group, we have used electrospray deposition as one of the method in preparing of particles. We have also made enzymatic, where cutting down the collagen into several peptides and then making into a products. So we also working on making collagen-based particles. We have also used carbohydrates as a cross-linker, wherein in enhancing the thermal stability, where we were making into collagen-based particles. This is one of the applications where we talk to correlate with your vascular applications, making the collagens into biotubes. This is, if you just do a literature survey, you can see this is like just a tube where you can have, you can load the drugs across the tubes, and then and it will also give you a strength. So now people also look into making the tubes, but it's going to be a very challenging in the cases of making the tubes with collagens. Collagen mesh, This is similar to about the membranes or scaffolds. This mesh preparation is what people are now primarily focusing on using bioinks. They're working on the mesh. The one advantage, if you talk about the scaffolds and this mesh, or you talk about printing in the bioprinter, is that the porosity can be uniform. Whereas if you make about using this collagens in the scaffolds, it may not to be very uniform, and then that makes a very challenging. Whereas when you print it, since it's your design, it's going to be printed, so the uniformity will be better. And these meshes are used for bandages, for reconstructs, and these can be also used for the grafts and the stents. And this is what I was talking about, the collagen supplements with respect to the pellets formations. Now people have been coming up with health drinks, collagen powders, and then collagen tablets are now in the market as a diet supplementations. We have also attempted to make collagen-based food products, but since under progress, probably we might come up with collagen-based products for food applications. And this is a bioadhesive. It is similar to the gels. Where when I talk about the bioadhesive, it's more of surgery applications, where post-surgical injuries, restoration, and regeneration of the tissues is what these bioadhesives are commonly being used. And this is collagen bioink, where we pitched up earlier. And I just want to conclude with my current area on this hybrid mesoporous particles. If you do a literature with any mesoporous particles, very particularly with collagen alone, these all are metal-based products where these mesoporous particles are being prepared. Very commonly, silica, then the carbon, and lipid-based mesoporous particles have been recently reported by our research group. And I'm focusing on this preparing a mesoporous particle using collagen and lipids, so that it can have a versatility or resembling the extracellular materials and accommodating a versatile drugs. It is in the very early stage, but we are successful in making the particles in accommodating a lipid plus a collagen and then into a materials for a drug delivery applications. And the top, you guys are seeing, we are just working on this collagen-based biolinks. That is the one which we developed at the lab, and then we just started to print for biological applications. And just to highlight, you might be feeling that I've never spoken about the disadvantages. Since it's going to be an undergrad and postgrads, let me focus more on this positivity about the collagen applications, where you can give your thoughts in coming up with new projects, new different of applications, and new area of venturing into it. Collagen is a very versatile material. You will have broad spectrum of application, A to Z in biomedicals, foods, cosmetics, though food and cosmetics has not been covered in the presentations, but people have mentioned cosmetic applications in collagen is booming. Facial masks, facial creams, you name the products, now collagen is ruling the cosmetic industries, even in the food industry. And the biodegradability is a key advantage, is what is always chosen, so that it will fall into an eco-acceptable category. But nevertheless, yes, we are trying to address the biodegradability by a cross-linking agent to enhance the applications. Now that is what the people are focusing more, where the cross-linkers are going to be, whether it's going to be a biodegradable or a bio-acceptable is what people are working on it. And market demand, a booming collagen market. If you are Googling on the anything else, the collagen market is so huge. So people are working towards this product, so that the people can developing a product at college level and becoming an entrepreneur is a very successful way or a way forward. And I just want to leave it with a word. Collagen being of so unique, but the challenges with collagen is what I just want to highlight. One is a purification process and culling it out from the skins. And then the choice of materials is also a critical factor nowadays. But of course, yes, but those can be overcome with scientific inputs, and then we can develop into a good product. Thanks for your kind patience.
Thank you, sir, for an informative session. It was very informative. I'm pretty sure many people learned about different ways to use collagen for biomedical applications. We have a couple of questions here from YouTube, sir. So can I ask them to you now?
Yes.
Okay, sir. So the first question is, one second, sir. How can a collagen degradation in totality be identified when used in nerve regeneration from a replacement point of view?
That's what I didn't went to an intricate level, but the point is that usually the biodegradation of collagens, when we talk about, the hydroxyproline release is what the marker for the biodegradation. Hydroxyproline is an indicator when you are finding the hydroxyproline in the content out, it means your collagen molecule is going to be degraded. So that is a marker where we usually work on. Hydroxyproline release is a way where we usually determine the degradability of the protein. There is a standard methods is there where the hydroxyprolines are usually being estimated.
Okay, so the next question is from Dr. Vijay Shekhar, and he wants to know, the solubility of collagen is poor. Can you suggest me a better dissolving agent?
Collagen is an insoluble in water. That is what the very unique about the protein itself. People conventionally use acid solubilization, where we conventionally use acetic acid for solubilization. And then we do reduce the concentration of acid using a dialysis with 0.05 molarity of acetic acid. And then we use it for other applications. Of course, what's the key challenge when you talk about converting from the acidic form to the neutral change is about the fibril formations, which is going to be a critical. And depending upon the application, you can still fine tune with the composite materials. The universal, I can say it in that way also. Universally, the acetic acid is what preferred for solubilization.
Okay, sir. The next question is from Ramesh Srinivasan, and he's asked, what can be the maximum threshold levels of collagen when used for bone graft substitute?
Threshold, I really don't have the values with me.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, yes.
Okay, sir. So do we move on to the next question then?
I just want to clear with the audience who are watching. I just given an overview, and to be very precise, I mostly working on this collagen cross-linking and then collagen stabilization is what more kind of my fundamental applications. So with respect to this, I just took all, I think that's why I gave all the references at the bottom of the slides where people can venture it and then can get it and can also email me if they want any the specific answers. Because I just did a vast literature survey across the science and then pulled out basically so that to give an insights to the undergrad specifically, because for their dissertation work, choosing collagen as a material for various applications. Yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Well, the next question that they have is, which is the best animal source for collagen? Fish scale collagen is effective compared to other animal source collagen. Is it so?
See, I cannot answer this. It will be a debatable on my topic. See, each species has its own advantage and disadvantages, and how people accept. Region-wise, acceptable rate is there. Ethnicity, acceptable rate is there. So we can't group it, this is better, that is better. So writing an article and publishing paper is different, but when talking, no, that will not be fit. Now people are working on different, conventionally people work more on this animal-based materials from bovine, people are using it, bovine-based materials. Now people to reduce that, people are working on fish-based has come up, application fish based collagen materials. Even to add that, people now working on this recombinant proteins for the application. So it is not that you cannot group it, this is better, that is better. Everything has its own its applications and then functionality. So I don't want to comment on that per se. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, sir. The next question is, what is the best source for collagen extraction according to you?
Best to source? I would not say that is the best to source, but I usually work with rat tail tendons and bovine ageless tendon and skin, goat skin is what I usually do where I'm very comfortable. If you put all the three together, I work rat tail tendon would be a more convenient way because the cross-linking is less in the cases of rat tail tendons because the functionality of the rat tails are very less where the cross-linking is also very minimum. But when you take about this HLS tendons from bovines, where it's going to be a high cross-linking because of load-bearing capacity, so solubilization is a very challenging task. So that will be a very critical factor. And then if you talk about the skin, extracting collagen from the skin, since it's going to be a very complex material, and you have to do for a series of processes, that is the number of processes is high, and your purity level coming out will be also less as compared to when you talk about rat tail tendons. So it depends on the individuals who have an expertise. But for anyone who wants to start and then venture into for this biomedical applications, rat tail tendons would be a very good thing. But then someone who want to go for an, a higher scale productions can be a HLS tendons and the skin would be a good source.
Okay, sir. The next question is, the collagen isolation is a big process and is high in cost. How do you collect the mass quantity of collagen?
That is what people do. People are doing an upscaling process and there's manufacturing units are there. So it's very complex process. As you have mentioned, the collagen extraction is a very complex and intricate process. So that is why the collagen cost, the collagen still, no, if you go and see the Sigma products, collagen is very huge. So now that's what people are working on it. I don't know, like what is the clarity? What is the question? Can you repeat?
Yes, sir. One second, sir. Collagen isolation and extraction, is it, excuse me, sir, one second. Collagen isolation costs, I'll rephrase it for you, sir. Collagen extraction and isolation costs a lot of money. So how do you collect it in a mass quantity and effectively?
I'm not working on this commercialization perspective, but how do you want to collect a mass? You have to minimize your steps or people are working on minimizing steps in the product and extraction of collagen also. And the other thing is that where you can working on the concentrations or the downstream processings, say there we have to work cut down so that the cost minimizations will be there. So it's about the technologies. In fact, CLRA is very known for collagen-based technologies. So we have baskets of technology with respect to collagens, starting from sutures to, in our group, people have worked on for leprosy wound treatments. It's very successful. People have extracting gelatin for commercializations and people have transferred. So, people are still working with it cost effectively. It's about the technology, what you choose.
Okay, sir. The next question is, there are different types of collagen. Which type is the best for these applications?
Blindly we can say that we work on type 1 collagen. And then people then work on type 2 with cartilages based. But type 1 is what people mostly talk is mostly on type 1 collagen.
Okay, the next question is there any chance of degradation of collagen after being filled for various treatments and how durable are those treatments?
This collagen as such is going to be a biodegradable material where in some cases you will be expecting it to be bioabsorbed. Where that's why you prefer a collagen molecules. For example, when you go for a topical treatment or in a wound healing applications, topical wounds or a burnt wounds, where once the materials, the regenerations of cells occurs and the collagen is being synthesized, and these materials also needs to be absorbed. But the point is that how long and duration, okay? And in the cases of if you go for a graft or a stems, where there should not be any biodegradable at all, because their role is going to be is already defined. So depending upon the functionality, the durability. Now the durability is primarily depend not only the collagen material as such, what type of a composites you use and what type of a crosslinkers you also use. That also plays a critical role.
Okay, sir. The next question is, how big is the current market for collagen-based products and treatments?
How big? Probably I didn't add a literature on that, what is in quantifiable numbers, but the market is huge. Being a visiting researcher to National Institute of Material Science, Japan, I was a visiting researcher. When you go any shops where you can see collagen-based products, where collagen masks, collagen gels, collagen lotions. So the market is huge. Even now, when one of those students have been started to work on those dietary products, it's booming, collagen-based. In fact, I had a cartilage replacement. Even doctors were prescribing the collagen tablets. So the market is huge. Might be I'm sorry that I cannot give you the numbers, but with respect to the bone graft, I think I've given the percentage. There will be an increase around like more than 6% in the coming years. So market is huge, but acceptable rate is what the people are looking forward.
Okay, sir. The next question is, if the collagen is insoluble, how does it reabsorb sutures? And they don't understand this part here.
See, now let us not talk about all these extraction and all. Now you take a skin, which is going to be where the collagen is going to be a primary materials. Okay, and then you put it out. Now, how does it go for degradation, correct? So in a similar way, collagen as such, it will be a degradable. The solubility is a different factor. See, solubility come into a picture where I want to readily convert into a different forms. Now I take a tendon, either a rattle tendon or a bovine HLS tendon or a skin for a material, and I leave it outside. Naturally, it will go for a degradation process. Now what is this insolubility is going to come into a picture is only the interaction with the water molecules and then breaking down into components. These collagen molecules, when I talk about the tendon levels, it's not a collagen as such. That will be the collagen, and then the five collagen molecules join to form a pentafibrillar level, and this pentafibrillar levels again into form a microfibril states, the bundles. Now, during this insolubilization, you are primarily cutting down these units and bringing into a monomeric form of collagen is what you finally work on it. And that is what you make it into a different product, and then you are using it for bioabsorption. Then in that case, the bioabsorption or the one, the material has to be degradable. The choice of cross-linking or the choice of composites you are going to add it along with the collagen is what the control the degradability. So you don't need to confuse the insoluble nature of the collagen, the insoluble nature of the not a collagen, the collagen fibrils or a collagen architecture is what the insolubility is all about. Yes?
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. So, thank you, sir. The next question we have is there any chance of degradation of collagen after being filled for various treatments, and how durable are these treatments?
I would put it in a single word. Yes, there are disadvantages. You can get it.
Okay. Can you elaborate on the disadvantage, sir?
No, see, of course, see, people are coming up with if these molecules for any applications, for example, if you use for stents, if the cross-linking is not going to be effective, or if there is going to be any the material preparations or any other interferences, will eventually leads to the dysfunction of the materials. Definitely, but not many cases where people work much. But of course, there will be a disadvantage. Those disadvantages are the still scope for us to do research and venture into how to strengthen it. Of course, there are.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. And the last question for this session is, when there is too much collagen, the skin can become thicker or harden. How can you avoid this issue?
So this is basically, you know, it is not about too much collagen, or you can say the more of this advanced glycation products, people with respect to aging, where there's heavy cross-linking occurs. So those are the primary factors, you know, where you get, you know, these wrinkle formations. It's not about too much, I would say. It's about more of cross-linkings. And there's advanced glycation end products or the synthesis where these will give you complications as such.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. With that, we end our Q&A session. Thank you very much, sir. It was indeed a very informative session. I'm sure many of us learned a lot, especially I'm sure if many people are looking into this research, it'll help them with their projects and to create more products. And also, thank you very much for taking your time to answer some of our participants' questions, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I now call upon our advisor, Dr. Renuka Vishwanathan, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's an honor to propose a vote of thanks on behalf of the Department of Biotechnology and on my own behalf on this August event, BioTalk Series Week 8 program. First, I wish to thank God for making this event happen. And I wish to express my gratitude to our management, St. Joseph's College of Engineering and St. Joseph's Group of Institutions, Chairman Dr. B. Babu Manohan sir, Managing Director Ms. Jesipriya ma'am, and Director Mr. Sasi Shekhar sir, for giving us this opportunity and platform to conduct this event. I would also like to thank our Principal Dr. V. Seshagiri Rao and Dean Dr. M. Parvathavardhani for their encouragement. I thank our HOD, Dr. D. Shrikumar, for his moral support and guidance. I also wish to thank the faculty of the department for their cooperation. I heartily thank the speaker of today's program, Dr. Jayakumar, scientist, CLRI, for his interesting and provocative presentation on collagen and its biomedical applications. It will be very useful for the students to pursue research in this field. I wish to express my thanks to the organizer, Dr. N. Chamundeshwari, for the arrangements and the successful conduction of this program. I thank all the participants from various destinations for their keen interest in taking part in this webinar. Last but not the least, the anchors and the students' technical team for their support in the smooth sailing of this program. With a few words of gratitude, showing gratitude is one of the simplest yet most powerful things human can do to each other. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, ma'am. And once again, thank you to the speaker. Before we wind up, I'd like to remind you all that the feedback link has been posted in the chat box and it is necessary to fill it up for receiving the e-certificate. Ensure that you enter the correct details, especially your name, institute name, and the email ID, as they will be used to generate the certificates and to send them to you. The certificates will be printed with the spellings you have been given and no changes will be made after that. Once again, I'd like to thank you all for attending this session. I hope to see you all in future events organized by the Department of Biotechnology from St. Joseph's College of Engineering. Until then, take care and stay safe. Thank you.